so good to see you on a little bit of a rainy Father's Day. I cannot think of a better way to start any service, much less a Father's Day, than a baptism. We will move heaven and earth to fill this pool up and to help people fulfill the command after they have trusted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior to be baptized. Remember, baptism does not save you, but it is one of the first things God wants us to do after we have been saved. Now, we're blessed today. We have three members of the same family, the Carr family. They're going to be baptized. One wonderful thing that happened during our COVID lockdown, the teaching from mom and dad and grandparents continued, the teaching of the Word of God, and God moved in these three little hearts, and they trusted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And so we're going to baptize them today. Savior Jesus Christ, your obedience to him, I now baptize you, Mason, my Christian brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're buried in the likeness of his death, and we're raised in the likeness of his glorious resurrection. Adjustment here. Church, this is Malaysia. She too has trusted Christ as her Savior, desires to be baptized. Let's pray for her as well. And now, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize you, Malaysia, my Christian sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death and raised in the likeness of his glorious resurrection. First Mason in Malaysia, and this is Marty Carr. You pray for him. Now, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize you, Marty, my Christian brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are indeed buried in the likeness of his death and raised in the likeness of his glorious resurrection. Amen. We can fill these waters at any time for you to obey the command of the Lord to follow him in baptism. We'll be right back.
Thank you, Lynn. Choir did a great job. By the way, I finally found the book of Philemon later that night. Inside joke here. We call him Abraham. He's a man in the Bible that we are introduced to before we even get out of the first 12 chapters of the book of Genesis. Unlike Philemon, his name is scattered all over the Bible. Philemon has one verse. Abraham has dozens and dozens of verses. He's equal in many ways. I mean, he's up there with Moses, David, Job, Daniel, the Apostle Paul. While he's known as an Old Testament figure, his name appears in more books of our Bible than just Genesis, and really than just in the Old Testament. He's also mentioned in Joshua, Nehemiah, Isaiah, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Matthew, Luke, John, Hebrews, James, Galatians, and Romans, and I don't think that's every book mentioned. He's mentioned a lot in Scripture, and his story, which is the story of Abraham, is pretty much over by the midway point of the book of Genesis. He's commented on and communicated throughout all of biblical history. Now, his name catches our attention on this day, Father's Day, because he's often called Father Abraham. There's children's songs about that, Father Abraham, dun dun. Y'all know it, okay? He was the one God called out to, and Abraham answered that call. And that the life of Abraham speaks to our heart today and to our Father's Day. God said to him one day, Abraham, I am going to make a great nation out of you. And by the way, if you can count the stars in the sky, or if you're able to count every piece of sand on the shore, then you will get close to knowing how many people you are going to be the father and the progenitor over. And so that was it. You know, it just made me stop and just put this in my notes. God always dreams bigger than we dream. And my point is this: when we say, God, my life is in your hands, lead me, show me. Now, we have ideas of what we want to be and what we aspire to be, and it's a lot of really good things, but God can take that dream and he can call you and raise you a bigger dream. That's what happened with Abraham. Abraham had no idea. He would be a father to a people that would eventually be scattered all over this planet. Though they are identified today in a very small area of our planet, the most fought over real estate in history, with more yet to come as we near the end of this age and the coming of Jesus Christ, our Savior. But the irony is, and this is so God, the irony is that for over half his life, he was not a father. And the promised one from Abraham and Sarah would come when Abraham was 100 years old and Sarah was in her 90s. Now, you do the math on that. Now, I know Abraham lived to be 175, but once you got an adult age, you were an adult age. And while it was not a virgin birth, it certainly was a miraculous birth, which is why Abraham and Sarah even laughed when the angel proffered that possibility that would happen. And so, you know, while I could only muster two sermons about Philemon, there are dozens of sermons I could preach on Abraham. And I do believe that often when we have these epic characters in the Bible, they're at this status that we feel like I would never aspire to that, or I could never do some of the things that Abraham did, but that's not what God says in his word. Now, we all have different roles, but God wants us to be the very best that we can be. And so that's something important to remember. And another thing to remember, and it's part of my outline, is the best of men are men at best. So here's, I want to give you three things about Abraham. We could not do one sermon on all his life. It encompasses a lot. But I want to talk first about faithful Abraham, that which he was known the best for. Then I want to talk about flawed Abraham, and that's my second point, and that is this, that all great men, all great women who have aspired and have done things, they too fight the same Satan that you fight. They too live in the same world that you live in, and they too have the same flesh that you have. And so it's important for us to not elevate them more than we should, but learn from everything about their life. So, faithful Abraham, flawed Abraham, and famous Abraham. Yes, we know Abraham. And I want to close it with a passage in Hebrews where he did make the Hall of Fame of Faith. But let's look in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1, where that story really begins. Genesis is the first book in the Bible, and so it's easy to get to. Verse 1 says this, "Now the Lord had said unto Abram, and which is his name before Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house into a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed." So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. That was his nephew. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Faithfulness. When we want to study about faithfulness, where do we go in our Bible? Well, there's a lot of places, but if we want a figure to look at in terms of faithfulness and our faith, yes, we can go to the Old Testament, and yes, we can go to one of the first major characters in our Bible, and that is Abraham. So what was Abraham faithful about? Now, as we look at this passage here in Genesis chapter 12, first of all, we can say he was faithful to the command. Faithful to the command. As you see in verse 1 from the get-go, when we first hear anything about Abraham, God is speaking to him and calling him to do something. And he gives it in the form of a specific command. God will always guide us when we say, "Lord, one day I want to be a preacher." Well, that may be your calling. And God will give you a command, and the command may be like, okay, go to seminary and study, or get close to a deacon or a Sunday school teacher or a peer in your church that knows the Bible. And God will always give the specifics. God doesn't live as we think he does in the vagaries of life. If you ask him by faith, he will in fact lead you. He is there every step of the way. But so he's faithful to the command. His adventure of faith began with a heeding of a command. And my friends, often that's where it starts. And that was to leave where he was and to leave who he was with and obey God. And we get by so much better when we just listen to the Lord. He listened. Now, Abram came, if you study your Bible, from a somewhat pagan culture and family. So God was calling him from that. More about that in just a minute. There are things now, right now in your life, often that God is commanding you. He's speaking to you through his word. And you know what it is. You come across a passage of scripture and you go, bam, that's it. That's me. That's what God is commanding me to do. And those are the first initial steps of faith, to believe God and go in the right direction. So let me ask you, what is God dealing with you about right now in your life? He's concerned about what is going on in your life right now. Dads, as a father, as a man, as a spiritual leader, what is God dealing with your heart about? And he is speaking to you. He doesn't speak audibly like he did in Bible times, but he speaks through the recesses, the Holy Spirit in our heart, and speaks to us about what we are to do. So initially, Abraham was faithful to what God said. And then a little bit more, he was faithful to his call, to the call. Verses 2 and 3 that we've already read, and he, verse 1, he tells him, he says, go, leave your country and go here to a land that I will tell you on a need-to-know basis. That's a life of faith. And then verses 2 and 3, he tells him what his calling is. I'm going to make a great nation out of you. That was his calling. God gave him a command that was commensurate with his call, and that call was, I am going to use you to lead a great nation. So he was faithful to that. The call was what God wanted him to be in this life. God calls us to different things in our life. We're not all the same. God calls good businessmen. God calls people in ministry. We're all in ministry together, no matter what our title and role and specific job is in this life. By the way, in the ancient world of Abram, just to be the leader or patriarch of anything, it was a dicey situation. There were tribal battles and divisions, and often if you were the leader of a family, if another tribe or family or group of people overtook yours, you were usually the first one to go, as we see. But he was still faithful to the call. We know that region of the world, even as we speak, are battling and fighting. And Abraham's story plays in centuries later, millenniums later, to what is going on right now in Israel. It was woven in their DNA when God led them, and he was going to show them. Verse 3, by the way, is why I'm never going to root against Israel ever in anything. Because the Bible says, regardless of what the political, what the military, what the geographical situation is, Israel is going to stay preserved and protected till Jesus Christ comes back. I've stood on the mountain looking in the valley of Megiddo, where one day the armies of the world will fight. And by the way, though it seems small, it is way bigger than you realize. And they are going to do battle in the end times there. So I'm never going to ever root against Israel. So he's faithful to the call. But then thirdly, he was faithful despite the circumstances. Now, we're talking about a life of faith. We're talking about Father Abraham. We're talking about faithful Abraham despite the circumstances. Now, for something to be a faith, it means doing something that maybe you can't see right now, but God sees it. So it involves a sacrifice of sorts, if you will. We like to live in the here and now, the flesh and blood, things we can touch and taste and feel. But God calls us to a plane and to a world in which he gives us vision in our mind and in our heart about what he wants for us. And if we will listen to him and we will obey him and we'll stay close to his word, he will lead us and guide us. And that is everything from your family to your kids, to parenting, to your relationships, to your job, to your church life, what church you're supposed to be in. God will cover all of that for us. Verse 4 seems to give the impression that Abraham did not dawdle at all. So despite circumstance, now think about this, and this hits us home. He had to leave the comfort of the only home that he knew. He had to leave the compassion of close family he knew, though some like Lot did come with him. He had to leave the culture of the life that he knew. You know what? Sometimes we could use us, all of us, in different ways. We could use a culture shock. That's why I think a mission trip is so good. You know, because this is a great big world that God has created, and there are some wonderful, beautiful people. Some of the greatest Christians I've ever met live in Port-au-Prince, Haiti. Some of the greatest believers I've ever known live in Quito, Ecuador. Some of the greatest Christians I know live in a place called San Pedro de Macorís, Dominican Republic. And so Abraham was having to leave that. You're not going to like this, but let me tell you this right now, and there's no getting around this. For you to live a life of faith, you can't always play the margins and stay comfortable. To live a life of faith, it's going to push the envelope of your life. And let me tell you ahead of time, sometimes it's uncomfortable. Sometimes it's different. Sometimes you are nervous as all get out, but yet you know God wants me to do this. Let me tell you, it's the greatest adventure you can ever live as a life of faith. If you just live your life on your feelings, you're only going to get so far in life. So Abraham taught us that. Fathers, God calls us to be leaders. He calls us to be good fathers. He calls us to care about our family more than the welfare of ourselves. Whole sermons could be made about the aspects of Abraham's faithfulness because we have other biblical commentaries on that faithfulness. That's the good thing. To get the whole picture of somebody in Scripture, read every verse that has to do with them. And so the New Testament verses make commentary to help us understand what living a life of faith means. Hebrews chapter 11, that great chapter, verses 8 and 9 makes this commentary about Abraham. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out not knowing whither he went. And here's this verse. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. So the New Testament confirms that, yes, he's an Old Testament figure, but he is the father of those that believe. So he was faithful to command, faithful to the call, faithful despite circumstances, and faithful to the covenant. Now, I'm fine-tuning a little here because the call would be the covenant. Now, in Abraham's life, if you look at his life, he got the command to go. He accepted the call of what God wanted him to do. He began to live his life. And we'll get to flawed Abraham first, but there were times along that journey, like in still in Genesis 12 and Genesis 16 and Genesis 15, excuse me, and Genesis 16 and Genesis 17, where God had to affirm or to reaffirm his covenant. It's kind of like when we make a decision in faith and then things are just trucking along really good and then boom, the devil or whatever, the circumstances, innocent or not so innocent, happened to us, and here we are. But yet we chose a life of faith. Don't undo in doubt what God has led you to do in faith. You only buckle down and say, God, I want to. But we all need help, and God brought help. And as far as the covenant was part that I am establishing a great nation, and I am going to preserve that nation despite them being scattered one day, despite them being conquered one day by evil empires, despite even in the modern era we go through something like the Holocaust in World War II. My covenant is I am not going to leave them nor forsake them. I'm going to graft in and adopt a new family, and that's most of us, a circumcision of the heart, the Gentiles, the heathen we were, but God adopted them, adopted us into his family. But Abraham was the leader of that covenant. And so God along the way reaffirms that. One in chapter 15 is when he gave him the sign of circumcision, and he had him in a Levitical kind of way sacrifice some animals that looked to and helped confirm that covenant. So we see those things in the life of Abraham's faithfulness. We don't have time to dwell on this, but even in Genesis chapter 14, when he had to rescue Lot from some kings, subdue him, he was met by a high priest called Melchizedek. At the very least, Melchizedek was a type of Christ. And at the very best, some believe it was an appearance of Christ in the Old Testament. But even then, Abraham, he was faithful. And he said, I won't take anything from these conquered kings except enough to feed my men, and I will give tithes. And he gave tithes to Melchizedek. Faithfulness, faithfulness, faithfulness. God wants us to be faithful. And then God works on us being consistent in our faithfulness. That's faithful Abraham, the father of those that believe. And that is the kind of life that he led. Romans 4 also comments on that, and where it says he is the father of those that believe. But number two, and this is where a lot of us live, let's take a moment and talk about flawed Abraham. Verse 12 in chapter 12, is a snapshot in Abraham's life. And it has to do when a famine came, a circumstance, not a good circumstance. Abraham and his large family, they were hungry, so they began looking for food. He went farther south and farther south and farther south till he was in the land of Egypt. And so in the land of Egypt, he came across Pharaoh. And probably because Abraham had, God had blessed him so richly, Pharaoh received him in and provided lodging. But we see here some flaws in Abraham. First, he was flawed in his devotion. What do you mean by that, Pastor? Well, in verses 8 and 9 of chapter 7, we see where Abraham had his family in worship. He built an altar and worshiped and thanked God for what he was and where he was in life. But there are things that can happen. And here's what happened in Abraham's. He was so desperate for food. He went to Egypt, and Pharaoh received him. But Abraham knew this culture of paganism, that if a king saw something that he wanted, the king was going to take it. And evidently, probably, to use a modern vernacular, Abraham's wife Sarah was probably drop-dead gorgeous. And Abraham was afraid. Abraham was afraid that Pharaoh will kill me and take my wife, because that's what he does. And so he stumbled in his faithfulness to God, and he gave a lie. He introduced Sarah, his wife, as his sister. Now, you say, well, that's not that big a thing. He was protecting his wife. But you know what? Here's what I believe. There are things that we do that we think that we can rationalize this thing to do. But God always has an answer if we'll only wait long enough for him to bring that answer. I've seen God do stuff for me that I wrench my brain about, and God like suddenly did it, and I go, gosh, it's so much better when God takes care of something than when I try to. So maybe I ought to listen to him. And so what happened, though, God was still, he was flawed in his devotion. Also, a huge point, to add a quick note for time's sake, his devotion to the, well, I'll save that for just a second, because we'll get to this next point. So he lapsed in his devotion and how he was going to take care of his family. But God watched over him in that. He probably should have stayed in the promised land, because bad things would ensue. There's a where it says going down into Egypt in the Bible, usually what follows that, though it seems like a physical thing, it's usually for God's people that something bad ended up happening. That's not the only instance that happened. And so for a quick note, in his devotion as well, he stumbled in that when he was given the promise of a child who would one day be Isaac, he stopped short of that. At his age, he began to worry. So he took his handmaiden Hagar and had a son named Ishmael. Ishmael is revered by the Muslim world. Abraham is a name revered by Muslims, Christians, and Jews, because he's part of that lineage that led to Ishmael. And we don't have time for that story, but that lapse in his devotion, in his faith, produced something that still reverberates to this day. Flawed in his devotion, but flawed in his emotion. Now, I specifically use this word here, specifically for dads and for men. Concern we have in our life brings anxiety. Anxiety brings fear. Max Lucado said fear is the actual thing you're afraid, the actual thing that is happening. Anxiety is the fear that it's going to happen. And that's why he says be anxious for nothing. And fear brings us to do things not of faith. And anxiety brings fear, and fear brings all kinds of emotion. And sometimes we men, we just go nuts with that. Under the sincere guise of protecting his wife, because he did love his life, and he did live in a vicious, ancient world, he stubbed his toe in his walk of faith. And so no doubt he was very emotional about that, and he rationalized that, and he got off track there. And that's often where we get off track. I know when I get angry, I can't name a time when I've gotten angry and out of control that any good thing ever happened. At the best, I end up having to apologize to somebody or take backward steps or eat crow or got egg on my face. And what I want us to understand is the best, whoever is the best Christian in this room, whoever it is, whoever the best woman Christian or man Christian or teenage Christian in this room, we all got problems. We wrestle with the devil. We fight the philosophy of this world to try and stay on track. If you knew the people that I knew, that we love and respect, we all are flawed. And the problem, here's the thing. As long as we're willing to let God work on those flaws in our life, then He's going to help us. His grace is sufficient. Is when we say, you know what, I'm this way, and I don't care what you say, I'm going to be that way, and if I want to get mad, I'm going to get mad, and I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. You know, how's that working out for you? Flawed in his motion, in his emotion, and then he's flawed but fixed from commotion. Now, we know in this story that Pharaoh was plagued. Abraham was more blessed. Pharaoh figured it out. He goes, what have you done? Abraham confessed. Because basically God says, don't you mess with Abraham. And so so God, even when we are flawed, He can and will fix the commotions in our life. You can be a great dad, a great provider, a great person of faith, but we're flawed and we make mistakes. Fathers must own up to their mistakes and family must understand that we are flawed. Then number three, talk about famous Abraham. I almost said famous Amos. He was pretty famous too, minor prophet. Now, why do I call it famous Abraham? Because he was. He is known. He had a famous name. First, God would change the name Abram, which means kind of exalted father. And it would add a little bit, which means to Abraham, which means father of a great nation and a mighty nation. So it was exalted, but exalted even farther to a great nation that exists today. And he would have affirmation of that covenant in Genesis 17. And he tells him. He's famous in that, as already said, he is known for, he is looked to and revered by Muslims, by Christians and Jews because of the connections there. A lot of times I feel like other religions steal from Christianity. They say Muslim tradition says that Hagar and Ishmael are buried near the Kaaba in Mecca in Saudi Arabia, where they go march around that. But nonetheless, when we say Abraham, that name is known. At Bryce's graduation get together, Dr. Abraham Rogozinski came, and it was so gracious of him to come. And of course, he knew Bryce when he was just a baby, and my daughter Tara worked for him, and he came, and his name is Abraham Rogozinski. His mother survived the Holocaust. I mean, a death camp. She walked out of a death camp. She survived and made it to the States, and both her boys went to the University of Florida, Florida Gators, and got a medical degree and made something of their life. And Abraham's son, Josh, did my reverse shoulder replacement. But Mrs. Rogozinski named her son Abraham. Why? Because that is a revered Jewish name of faith. So famous name, famous faith. Romans 4 says, therefore it is of faith that it might be grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only to that which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. In Galatians 4, Paul used Abraham as an example. Galatians 4, in talking about faith, and says that he had two sons. One was from the bondwoman, and that was Hagar, but the other was from the free woman, that was Sarah, of the free woman was by promise. In other words, it was Isaac that God wanted Abraham and Sarah to have, and that would be, could carry that line of patriarchs that to this day the nation Israel exists and they look back. Hebrews 11 is called the Hall of Fame of Faith, and I already read you a couple of verses about Abraham in that. Verse 8, he was called to go to receive an inheritance. He obeyed. He went out not knowing whither he went, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise, the connection that was there. And then verse number 10 says this, for he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. A life of faith says, God, I'm going to obey you. I'm going to trust you, even when it's tough. And Father, if I stumble or when I stumble, because I'm going to stumble, I'm going to try to listen to you, and I'm going to get back up my feet, and I'm going to continue a life of faith. I'm not going to scrap. I'm not going to scrap my life because I mess it up, or circumstances try to mess it up, or the devil himself tries to ruin it. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. But God, I'm going to walk in faith in you. And I'm not just walking to look to see what's around the corner next month, next year, but I'm looking one day for a city made by you, better than Jerusalem, the earthly Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem, whose builder and maker is God. So let's take a different way that we look at some of our Old Testament figures. Abraham was full of faith, and he trusted God, and it was, the Bible says, it was counted unto him for righteousness. You know, George Bush had an interview after he was president, and they said, what's your legacy, President Bush? And he goes, I don't know. He goes, it's too early. Only time will tell what my legacy is. And the years go by, and he goes, the legacy's not for me. It's for those that will look back on my life and say what kind of president that I was. And if we look back on our life, we can look at the steps that we have taken, the failures that we've inevitably had in our life, but maybe we've gotten back up by God's grace and we've walked forward. There's a Phil Wickham song. I'm not going to play it, but I want to read one of the verses in here, the chorus in it. And it's a song called, and look it up when you get a chance today, Phil Wickham, It's Always Been You. And he says, you are the voice that calms the storm inside me, castle walls that stand around me. All this time, my guardian was you. You are the light that shines in every tunnel. There in the past, you'll be there tomorrow. All my life, your love was breaking through. It's always been you. Let's live a life of faith by God's grace.